German Korean project artistic activity and to facilitate critical reflection both bilaterally, that is Germany, Korea, or multilaterally, other European countries, or even between. Finally, a project that we did with a fellow panelist here, contribution and possible organization on Franco-German-Korean project.
Good evening and welcome to Future Factories, which is the hybrid event related to the Make Stream. To kind of give a little bit of context on the event, I'll just give a short introduction. But the idea of Future Factories came from considering the fact of digital fabrication, manufacturing processes, miniaturization of manufacturing processes, and also the potential then for how, in essence, your kitchen can become essentially a future factory, and kind of pushing that logic in terms of these new manufacturing processes, what they might kind of lead to in relation to the practices of designers, engineers, and so forth. Parallel to that, there was also an interest in, if we take that kind of possibility, what then are the related working practices that might emerge around that? The working practice in particular in relation to peer-to-peer learning, collectivism, what it means to produce in various different formats, in particularly looking at open hardware and concepts of open manufacturing processes. So essentially, this is kind of the core kind of nub of the conversation between the panelists this evening. And the way we're going to kind of work it is to have short 10-minute presentations from each speaker. In a sense, they're sort of provocations on the topic, which will then kind of bounce back between us in the panel kind of discussion, and then we'll throw it out to the floor for further conversation. As it's a hybrid event, it was also important as part of that kind of practice was to bring some examples of what we're actually meaning. And I leave each one of the panelists to describe in more detail the prototypes and tools that they have actually brought. So to introduce the first speaker, Alison B. Powell is Assistant Professor at the Media and Communication Department at the London School of Economics. She's also the Director of the Data and Society Programme there. Alison's research focuses on practices of Wi-Fi hacking, as well as most recently on open hardware licenses. And her work, her presentation today, will focus on this question of what we mean by openness and also the implications of open hardware licenses. Following Alison, Matthias Tarasiewicz will be speaking. Matthias is from Vienna. He is the founder and the director of Artistic Bouquet. He's also the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Research Cultures, which is a recent journal that has just been launched recently. Prior to that, he was also founder and director of Coded Cultures, and also has worked as an artist and a programmer himself, and perhaps some of you might know his Bitcoin Cloud project, which actually won multiple awards. Following Matthias, then Jussi Ängeslevä will, just to say that Matthias's discussion will focus on an open hardware camera that they have been making and discussing kind of the implications and the processes involved in producing that camera. Following then Matthias, Jussi Ängeslevä is a professor at the digital media department in the University of Utica, the University of Fine Arts here in Berlin. He's also the vice creative director at Art and Com, and also has a long history, artistic practice in creating digital interactive installations and artworks for the last about 20 years. He's also an educator and will be speaking in particular about his projects which related to a recent project which was rethinking prototyping. So that's just kind of a broad sketch basically of each speaker's position. And as I mentioned, 10 minutes, and then we'll open it up for discussion. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Alison.
Thank you very much, Teresa. I'm really delighted to be here. I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the work that I've just completed, which has looked at open licenses and trust mechanisms in open hardware development contexts. I started looking at open culture about between 10 and 15 years ago when I was doing some work with open Wi-Fi communities in Montreal. And here's a photograph of an installation of an open Wi-Fi node on the roof of a building in Montreal, which is taken from my field work. And what I noticed when I was working with this community of open Wi-Fi hackers was that there was a concept that they had of using and expanding openness beyond, at the time, we were interested in open software, and the group was using free and open source software to operate their network by flashing Wi-Fi routers with open source software, taking advantage of the fact that they had a Linux core. But very quickly, it became evident that there was also a real interest in opening up the processes of using hardware so that people could modify the hardware components that they were employing to make them work differently. For example, by increasing the power so that the routers could transmit greater with a stronger signal strength or over longer distances. And so I became very interested in this idea of the kind of transformation of the open source software mode of thinking and the open source software mode of working from the software world to the hardware world. And if you can think about hardware, you can think that there's obviously some convergence, because clearly we have in the information technology world, we have a convergence of software and hardware, as we have software-controlled chipsets, for example, and we have a sort of expansion of microcontrollers. So you have many more things that can be worked on from a software perspective, and therefore from an open software perspective. But equally, when we think about fabrication, we still have lots of material constraints for making things open. So this opened up some questions for me, like how do you define what is open? Is it enough that the object's design should be open? Does that just mean the schematics? Does it mean the mode of manufacturing? Does it mean the materials list? How far down do you need to go? And then when you get to the bottom, what do you find? How do you make everything open? I think in conceptual terms, you start finding that there is a kind of geology of openness, as much as there's a sort of geology of media, to sort of pull on some of Jussi Parikka's work. So I was very interested as a social scientist in the question of how did we get from open source software to all of the other open processes that are now part of our cultural life. Things like open citizen science, open hardware production, and open collaboration structures. It turns out that these are all very different. So I started asking myself in my work, what is open? And what is openness? And I argue that openness is a value that intermediates between reusable software code, institutional transparency, and expanded opportunities for participation in knowledge production cultures. And this is positioning openness as a kind of boundary between a particular way of working that originated within free and open source software communities, which is actually quite culturally specific. Probably many of you know about this cultural specificity, but I would like to note that it's very culturally specific. And some broader democratic values, like trying to make our institutions more transparent and more accountable, and perhaps more democratic. And then a sort of third cultural value, which is this notion of participation, an expansion of participation in producing knowledge. So we have a kind of number of things that are, all of them are quite different, and they have been collapsed together into one goal of openness. And I think, as I think you might see in certainly in these presentations, this means that we will always run into tensions, because there are many different things that openness means. And when we run into tensions, we will have boundaries, and we will have boundaries between different ways of thinking, different ways of working, and different kinds of cultural values. And I just want to put that out at the beginning, because I think it helps us to do the work when we acknowledge that there are going to be these boundaries. So the next question I had was, why is openness expanding now? Why do we have this interest in this cultural transformation? And I've got, of course, lots of illustrations of various open hardware projects throughout these slides. And if you'd like to know anything more about an image that I've got, please come and ask me later. Some of these are more famous than others, as I've got Vinay Gupta's Hexayurt project up here as one example. So why is openness expanding? Well, there's four factors within the kind of contemporary communicative environment that generate complexity with respect to knowledge. And these include extensive networking of communicative practice and communication infrastructures. So we are more connected to more people. We are able to communicate to more people. And so therefore, we have the capacity of working with and learning from and building with many, many different people. We also have, we've experienced a change in modes of access to knowledge. We can gain knowledge from many different sources, and these don't have to be top-down. They don't have to come from the university. They can come from people who share information with us online. They can come from people that we meet in makerspaces. They can come from people that we meet at conferences. And there is much more of a horizontal sharing of knowledge and a networked experience of access to knowledge. And of course, this is under threat. There is a in the sort of everyday communication world, there is an intensification of corporate platforms, but still, this is what we have experienced. And we've also learned how to collaborate with different people who are different from us and live in different places. And this means that we've moved away from only relying on institutional forms of knowledge, or what in my field is called constituted knowledge. That's the knowledge that a university has, or a large business has. And that means that there's a kind of explosion of different ways of working together, and therefore different ways of valuing knowledge. So open hardware has meant many things to many people. For some people, it's meant maker bots. For some people, it's meant open designs for industrial materials. For others, it's meant designs for stoves that can be safely used by people in many places in the world to avoid internal air pollution. But because open hardware has meant so many things to so many people, one of the main challenges that we've had in the open hardware world is that because of these tensions between the different ways of thinking about openness, people have wanted to organize and license and standardize open hardware forever. And they've tried to do it in about a zillion different ways. When I started my project on open hardware, I made a list of all of the open hardware licenses that I could find. And it was really long, and it's still growing. And nobody has managed to solve this problem, in part because nobody has managed to solve the problem of whose knowledge is most important. And I don't have much time, but I want to really briefly talk about one particular open hardware licensing project that really brought this out to me. And this is my investigation of the CERN open hardware license. And these are some photographs I took when I went to do some fieldwork at CERN, where a guy named Javier Serrano works in the photonics division, where they are creating extremely complicated optical technology. And this technology they buy for extremely expensive prices from a small number of very bespoke manufacturers. And Javier, in his spare time, is also a member of a number of open source communities. And so he is a person who has both an institutional position within a very, very significant scientific institution with a lot of legitimacy, and a person who believes firmly in the value of sharing knowledge and in the quality of the knowledge that you get from that networked mode of encounter. So Javier decided that he was going to create an open hardware license within CERN, but that he wasn't going to make it only speak to CERN's concerns, that he was also going to allow the open hardware community to comment on the development of the license. So there's just some details behind me on exactly how he sought to do this. And here's a chart of different kinds of knowledge that I identified in the process of debating this license. And I won't bore you with describing this, but I will just summarize the fact that the license was trying to balance these two different kinds of authority or legitimacy, these two different ways of thinking about whose knowledge is important. And essentially, they debated whether or not the license should act in a way that benefited CERN's interests more, or whether the license should act in a way that benefited more the people in the open source community. And they went with the benefit to the open source community. You can ask me about the details later, but I think that is the important thing to take away, is that there is a kind of interesting set of conflicts and tensions that were at work in that project that are not only about how they were, that not only illustrate the significance of how they resolved that problem in the moment, but that are significant for all of our efforts to negotiate this multiple meaning thing of openness. So what I found in this project, which continued past open hardware and into open science, well, I found that the model represented by the CERN license depended both on a good faith in the institution as being a place where you could leave knowledge safely. They run a very important repository for open hardware designs. And that repository is never going to go away because CERN, as an institution, is big, has money, and most importantly, has significant legitimacy. But it's also a case in which the values of the people who are participating in the open source community and who wanted to be able to use the license in a way that benefited them were also taken into account. So it needed to, this project illustrated that these institutions also need to be flexible. And as sort of Teresa's framing of this entire stream has identified, market-based and entrepreneurial cultures have already appropriated lots of aspects of the DIY culture. And this might be perhaps to its detriment because it moves away from this notion of knowledge as something that is inherently more valuable as it's shared and collectively developed. But what I can see now in my more recent research, and we should talk about this in the discussion, is that there are new trust and negotiation mechanisms that can integrate data and a sort of sense of where designs come from, and that can create the circuits necessary to make these kinds of licenses not just validated by the community, but actually useful by the community. And I will just point to one of the images here, which is the Ohanda project, which I worked on with some other people who are also in the room, and which has a kind of key system for linking an object's, the design of an object with the creator of an object. Right, I'll finish.
Yeah, hello and thank you for having me. Thank you for the invitation, Teresa. I will be talking today about the project with the name Axiom. It's an open hardware project which I'm not the inventor of it, so I was working together on, and I'm still working together with the community of the Axiom project. And I also brought you a small documentation print, so there's maybe still 20 left, so if you're interested, I can hand you out some after our talk. And actually, what is this camera and why did we produce it? It's actually an open hardware camera, but I will also explain a little bit in my brief introduction why it's also complicated to use this term open hardware, because in my opinion, especially the term openness is very problematic if you look at the specificity. It is not only from the community, but from the actual hardware that we are using in this project. So first to answer the question why we came up, or why the community came up with creating an open hardware camera, what is the need for it? Because you would guess, okay, you have a lot of cameras out there, why not just plugging them in and using them? So basically, I don't know if this is readable because it's pretty, oh, but it's okay. So there's a lot of proprietary camera manufacturers that produce cameras which are usable for one specific context. Maybe a good example to understand what I mean is there was the DSLR hacking community, or like movement, that started a few years ago with people starting to reverse engineer the firmware of the camera to make it more usable, or to make it do more than it was usually intended to do. So in a way to break out of this intended use of the manufacturers. And as we also heard in the talk from Alison, it's actually not only in cameras, but also you had this a lot in different routers or different technological devices that we are using, that you are bound to the use a manufacturer gives you, to how to use this kind of devices. And looking at the professional camera context, or professional movie or film production context, it's quite of a DIY aspect, because the whole workflow, everything is kind of very put together, and not like using, you're limited in your artistic things that you can do with a particular device through what the manufacturers intend and want you to do with these devices. So this is maybe the most important aspect why we are developing this camera. And also, it's maybe not a big reason, but there is actually no really open source camera out there, so we thought, why not creating one? So the project exists since 2006, and it's maybe, it's a little bit hard to really put the community in numbers, because there were so many people contributing over the years, and still are a lot of people involved in this. So I would say it's in total over 120 people involved in this project, although there are a few people which are doing more, and a few people also getting paid now in the project. So I started actively working with the community in 2015 as I'm running a small lab in Vienna, which tries to also be on the intersection between these kind of communities that work with open source hardware, or like with open tools, and with the academia, and then trying to create situations where both could benefit in a way. So just to briefly show you the history of the camera. So in 2013, there was the prototype developed. This is how it looked. It's was pretty huge, even for then, for cameras, because of all this miniaturization going on. Yeah, it was pretty huge. Although it worked, and it was like a fully functional prototype that would actually be developed I think it was like around 3,000 bucks euros. So yeah. So already it was used on the rig, and as you, I'm not aware of how many people know how these camera rigs are assembled, but usually they look like very DIY, so it looks even more professional camera rigs would look like that. So here's another picture of the camera. And it was not, we didn't actually, it was not intended to be like a very space efficient, so it was much more of a kind of a proof of concept. And now, just recently, and I also brought this with me, the beta is finished. Actually, the development of it was crowdfunded on Indiegogo, and it's mainly intended now for developers to start using the camera. And maybe to explain in what kind of problems we came developing this project. Here you see, for example, how a layout would work. I'm not sure if any one of you could like reproduce this, but this is also one problem that you have in open hardware. The question is who is actually able to benefit from you making these kind of designs open. So so it gets a little bit technical here. So you see the elements of the current beta, which is basically trying to reuse existing technology as well. So for example, we're using one board which is called the microset, which is an existing board. Think of it like the Arduino. And this is, for example, also a problem. This is not completely open. So the question is, in how far can you actually open up a hardware? And there's a lot of different aspects which are, of course, possible to open. But for example, some parts are not, because if you see here, there's a big image sensor a camera needs, of course, and this is pretty hard to open source because you need to have years and years of development to create your own image sensor. Although there are people in the apparatus community that want to develop their own open hardware sensor, it's not so likely that this will be done in the next 2 years. And here you see the open module system of the camera, which is basically the idea that users and developers could extend the camera with different input-output modules. So, for example, here you see an HDMI module which outputs the image, but also it would be possible to have like different inputs, completely different ways of using the camera. So the idea is, of course, also that people could rebuild the camera. So in this current version, it comes without an enclosure, so you could 3D print your enclosure. And we are also currently working on an European Union-funded project for the next step of the camera, which is the Axiom Gamma. So here you see our whole team of this, of different people working on the Gamma. It will be hopefully finished in by this year, like two existing pre-market prototypes. And just to give a few shout-outs to the all this logo placement stuff, but this is how the camera should actually look. Then this is the Gamma, and often it's confused that this would be a successor of the beta, but actually this is will be a much more expensive camera, and this is also a problem in terms of open hardware. The question is, if you open source things, they are not necessarily becoming cheaper. For us, actually, the because a lot of people think, ah, great, now we can get this camera and it's like much cheaper than buying a off-the-shelf camera. This, sadly, it's not the case. So for us, because we cannot buy these things in such huge quantities that it's like really cheaper. And also, you're not in this kind of production lines and production quantities that you can actually sell these things. Even selling the cameras is for us a big task, because you have to, if you want to sell physical objects worldwide, you run into so many different problems. So for example, you need like a lot of theoretically in all the continents different companies. So there's a lot of issues we're still facing with this. And some other challenges that we were actually seeing was mostly due to existing proprietary solutions. There's a huge amount of proprietary solutions around there, especially in the movie and film industry. And we have to interface at some point, of course, with them, because you need in the end to output an image or you need to record an image. And there's a lot of existing non-documented technology out there. So most of the time, I would say that the whole first 2 years of developing the camera was actually dedicated to reverse engineering existing technology or to interact with companies to sign NDAs and then somehow convince them later that we could maybe open source a few parts of the documentation or to make this kind of documentation available. But of course also another challenge was the dislocated work. It's like a huge amount of people involved in the process, and to make this manageable in a way is sometimes really challenging. And I want to actually close my short introduction here with a few other aspects that I think are important to talk about open hardware. So I'm referring here to a text that Richard Stallman was writing in Wired magazine in March 2015, where he's also pointing at the problem that we cannot think of open source hardware in the same terms as we are thinking of open source software, because it's fundamentally different. We have a lot of different problems we run into, which are, for example, the levels of openness that I just outlined briefly, which is, for example, if you would, maybe a good example is the Arduino platform, which is also like considered to be an open hardware, but then again, if you look closer, you have small chips on it which are not open at all. So it's the question of when are we starting to talk about open hardware. This is also what Alison was referring to, like, is it enough to just make the design available? Is it, when do we stop saying something is open? And there's also an interesting discourse going on between the CERN license and the Free Software Foundation, which also discussing that open hardware should actually be able to run open software, and then we could actually completely consider it open. But also you run into so many different aspects and problems of open source hardware, which is, for example, differences in copyright law and patent law, all which are maybe not so dominant in open source software, which become a totally different problem when we're talking about hardware and the physical object. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay. Wow, this is really exciting. So now I continue with what Teresa was introducing already. So I will run you through our experiences in this academic research project, Rethinking Prototyping. I ended up kind of hacking this whole Rethinking Prototyping in that our project, looking at the aura of the digitally fabricated, the project is called Beyond Prototyping. So actually it's not really about prototyping, but it's building products using digital fabrication techniques, but it flew in the application, so we got the funding and could do these things. So what we wanted to look at is also coming from the sort of from the world of the digital algorithmic creating into the world of the physical and the world of the objects, and thinking of somewhere in between something that is a mass product and something that is like an atelier service as one-offs. So somewhere between a copy shop and as an atelier, or somewhere between functional and something which is emotional, also kind of playing with the end user's relationship with the resulting things and the makers. So that's the essence of the Beyond Prototyping research project. So I will now show three of the outcomes that came out of that project. At the beginning, I must say, I expected that we would have thousands of great ideas that are leveraging beautifully the capabilities of digital fabrication that churn out unique, meaningful products for the everyday. But it turns out that it's really so the kind of 3D printer that can make anything and everything is anything but, so that it's still very, very limited in what kind of things make sense with the energy usage, with the price and all these kind of things, and the kind of physical forms possible. So the sort of a hello world in this this world is this, it's a product called ciphering, which is a ring that has a ciphered message. Effectively, it's an open SCAD script that runs on a web server that you can project numbers into a 3D file, And then we did lots of work in looking at, well, from the sort of the early ideas that you can put any image into, like encode it as a secret message that only becomes legible by casting a light through it or looking at it from the right point of view. But then you really quickly hit the limits, technical and physical limits, of what sort of a bridge weight is the minimum that you can print, and what gaps then don't get full of fat that it doesn't work anymore as a ring, and so forth. So, so therefore, we ended up with a 5-pixel font, 4 numbers, which in the context of a ring is meaningful. But for anything else, it's a debate. So it's kind of, so there's so many constraints that seem like, oh, it's like, for example, it's like this. But it's got so many technical constraints that in this case make sense, but in the sort of a general sense don't make any sense anymore. So we made this website where people can customize their ring, and then in the end they get this piece shipped home. We're using Shapeway, so completely closed source online service provider that mixes the sort of a, in this case it's actually quite nice because it's a 3D print wax model that gets cast in precious metal, in the sort of combining hundreds of years old technology with the cutting edge. So, but since it's a research project, so why did we do this? As much as it was looking at what kind of products make sense to encode in this kind of a dialogue between the designer, the manufacturing platform, in this case, Shapeways, and then the end user, is that running this and doing this, we could then talk at eye level with the audience, what do they think about it, which is often the case when you are presenting design proposals in academic conferences, not the case, because people don't want to be confrontational. So you do something and then you ask, do you like? People say yes, because they don't want to say no, because why would they? Because it's just an extra effort. So what we did, we collected lots of data of people who paid to participate in our study, because they would buy these rings and we could then ask them from all around the world, what is the meaning and the kind of essence of this digitally fabricated for them? And without going too much deeper into what we then learned, I think this is quite nice. So we were asking, who do you consider the designer of this ring? And the answers would be, so myself, because I chose the numbers, a computer, the person who programmed the algorithm, or the person who came up with the concept. The answer, by and large, was other, which probably means that we need to redesign this survey to get a little bit more information. But I mean, it's also pointing at the kind of so it was perfect result, because it's showing the ambiguity of the whole thing. And the other half of here saying that majority were feeling they were part of the design, and this is something like in this atelier service kind of mode, it makes perfect sense. But for me, it was probably also like getting the hands dirty in interfacing with real people in the academic project, was then these kind of things. So then people would start writing back, could you maybe do this? And because the limits that we put there based on the technical constraints are obviously not obvious to the audience. So I had lots of dialogue with people of their aspirations and how they would like to do different things differently, and then they would send me pictures like this. And I think the best thing there was this, so invitation to a wedding in Belgium as the result of the research project. So this was now completely automated production in a factory called Shapeways in different continents that resulted in material for our research. The second thing, locatable or locatable, whichever way you want to twist your tongue, is looking at different contexts. It's looking at a table, a place for conversation, where we wanted to make an interface to make the personal, meaningful table for yourself. And in this case, we used OpenStreetMaps as the platform. So extracting the vectors of streets from open street maps and then figuring out how many meters. Then looking at a 3D milling process of what kind of a tool head, how many meters is feasible. And then with this kind of study, we ended up with an aesthetic of a table that is producible within 30 minutes of milling and then lots of manual work after that. But so that we kind of set the limit so that it's feasible technically, economically, and aesthetically. We also did lots of studies then in casting the different resin to fill the gap so that it also works as a table, which is a nice thing if it's a table. So in this case, what we have, so these are all these different studies. So this case we have so we didn't do this in the comfortable quarters of university workshop, but instead, and then we made this web front where you can define a geo-coordinate and say what kind of a table, and then send us a quote. So we didn't do it within the constraints of the university, but instead, together with four small workshops in Berlin, so real industries or handicrafts, design studios, so we could operate within the constraints and limits and possibilities of the reality. So the traditional production, you would have a designer, deals with producer, sends it to factory and shop, and then you get it to the client. So we looked at this kind of a network of services where the design now takes place across the whole field because the technical people in the different workshops know much better what tool sets and what kind of settings make the best sense. Okay, so here we are in between the atelier service generative product, and so aspects about what we are trying to do is looking at where atelier service, everything is customized, mass product, you don't have anything customized, and parametric product is kind of somewhere in between where the meaning is defined by the user, but everything else is defined by us. The last thing, now I'm running out of time. The last thing is a different kind of model. It's a lampshade that starts as a custom scanner that you get delivered to home before you when you decide that I would like to have a lamp here. Then you use the light switch to turn on the scanner. The scanner then scans the room. And by doing this, you get a very nice interface to then define not how the lamp looks like, but where you would like to have the light. So this is now the interface on the website where you can then paint the light where you want. And what comes out of this thing is then, from the designer's point of view, completely predefined set of parameters that defines the aesthetic of the product that you get to receive as the final thing, not as a blueprint to design with. So you design the lighting and the designer designs the lampshade, the product. Yeah. So there's light guiding to different places. So I leave it at that. So this basically looking at, from my point of view, as you can see that it's, so the kind of tangent of the community is very different. So this was the community of the different makers predefining something where the product is open to the user, but in super easy and intuitive way from the point of view of what makes sense to them. So it's not really addressing the maker community as such, but the end user of the things. So I'd leave it at that.
We're just switching the camera that Matthias was speaking about on, so that you can kind of get some close-up back image there to help with the conversation. That's what's after happening there. Wow, I feel like I'm sitting in a panel here where actually the task of moderation is somehow, I don't know, slightly almost redundant because each of these practitioners have such a wealth of experience, and I know that there is an excitement around the topics. So for that reason, then the conversation is I think ready to just kind of pop out of us in some sort of way. but I thought it might be just useful to kind of like recap really on some of the kind of core things that we're stating. And Alison raised this point about openness and what we actually mean by it, and defined it as a set of values, a value in a sense. And I think that this is actually quite an important kind of aspect when we're talking about not just openness, but actually like modes of production. So if we think about these future factories and various modes of productions, what are the value sets that those modes of production actually embed? I think that's kind of one point. And then the other kind of key point then was, when does this openness stop and start? And you could apply that back then to that. When does that value system that's embedded within that production mode stop and start? And what are the challenges then in terms of that? What are the affordances and the limitations that it gives rise to? And I think, again, this kind of challenge to what is constituted knowledge and the boundary points came up, not just in Alison's conversation, but actually also then in Matthias's conversation about where exactly, as you kept reiterating, does the openness begin and end, and what then are those boundary points in a sense? But then I think Jussi also was pointing to the boundary points in relation to not just professional disciplinary sets, who is the designer, who is the maker, who is the fabricator, but in this case actually what's the user's role within that? So the boundary points there in all of the examples that you were giving are really at least blurring and kind of tossing up kind of hybrid manifestations that kind of also then chuck back to you in that noise further kind of reevaluations of what where things are happening along the chain. And I think the other kind of point that I just wanted to kind of pull out was something then in challenging those questions, not just of production modes, but also that relationship to modes of knowledge and how knowledge gets constituted, generated, pops back to kind of Alison really in a sense, and sort of tensions that arise as you articulate it between with the example in CERN, but also as you were expressing then, Matthias, as well, in these points of like where in the manufacturing kind of process again, these kind of boundaries blur. What are the kind of anxieties when you kind of get almost tensions and anxieties then that you kind of get into within that? So that's sort of a brushstroke really to try to bring together some of the points. What I kind of would like to do is maybe leave it open to you to pull out one of those threads or to bounce back on them. What you might have actually felt in relation to each other's perspectives. Perhaps, Alison, you could start the conversation rolling.
I think that, thank you, Teresa. That was a really good summary, I think. I wanted to kind of go into the tension, because I think that's a really interesting place, and I think we all went into the tension. And I think I want to highlight two aspects, actually maybe three, because you pull out the three aspects of the tension. And the first one is the turtles all the way down problem, right? So you know, like the old myth that the world is situated on the back of a turtle, and the guy goes to the elder and says, you know, elder, I would like to know, like, what is the turtle standing on? And the elder says, it's turtles all the way down. And this is the problem with openness, right? Like, how far down do you need to have a stack of turtles to say that the bottom turtle is still open, right? And Matthias, I think you articulated this really well, because is it that absolutely everything must be created in the same way? Or is it that the knowledge about the function of the camera is more broadly accessible than the knowledge about the function of an equivalently good camera that was not produced in an open way? Or is it that, you know, you could, like you had a design, that you could get access to the designs? And there are these three different ways of thinking about openness have been present in all of the projects that I've looked at, and sometimes they're directly in conflict with each other. So in my last research paper, which is about to be published in New Media and Society, so send me an email, and if you want a pre-press copy, I'll send it to you. I looked at a couple of different open hardware projects. So I looked at the CERN project, and then I also looked at the Public Lab of Science, which has an open repository. It's called Plots. But the Plots repository has a totally different sense of what openness is, which has to do with public labs' mandate for expanding scientific inquiry to the broadest number of people. So everything in their repository is cheap and easy to work, which is exactly like quite opposite to the way that CERN is thinking about open hardware, which is that you can get access to the designs. Because for CERN, it's great for people to have access to the designs so that when they put something out for tender, it's clearer exactly what kind of complicated electronics they want. And that possibly two different companies making really complicated optical equipment can then compete on the basis of making the best version of those designs. And then the third thing I was going to say is that there is this kind of openness with relation to the market that is this sort of third way, and I think that kind of connects to what you were talking about, Jussi. I don't know, do you want to pull on that?
I think one very important aspect that you just pointed out was that it's also a market decision to open up things. Like also for CERN, because I think one key aspect of technology in scientific use is also to actually control how we are gaining the information, or how we are sensing the world, so especially looking at the technology from CERN, but also repairability, which is one of the key elements that open hardware projects have, which is of course also good in terms of that you can use the things longer, but also from a market perspective, because if you invest in a technology which is repairable not only by you but by anyone, you would actually still be able to use it after some years. And there's a lot of tools, especially in digital production or like media production, existing where the company went bankrupt and you cannot use these tools anymore. So there's the documentation, or I don't know, it's like for example, it's like a big fire, and then all the documentation is away. I mean, I'm talking about times when before there was the cloud, but you never know, yeah. So there's a lot of other aspects, of course, as well that are not so community-driven, that are really market-driven. Yeah. So I would also say there is a different aspect of open hardware, which is more coming from a non-market perspective as well, of course, where it's of course also, which is very similar to what the open source software movement had in the beginning. So it was not about that everyone could program, but it's a kind of an expert exchange of information or of your tools to produce. I think this is also important because we're talking now about the maker context and the open hardware context, but actually open hardware is quite, not everyone can produce it, yeah? So I would say also we are still in this old discussion of the engineer-bricoleur difference in a way.
And that's really, there's some really tricky problems with that, right? Because if you're in the engineer-bricoleur mode, you're gonna have highly expert people. And you're going to have highly expert people who are, trying to compete with each other around improving the same kinds of designs. And then the knowledge that's important is this really specific and expert knowledge. And actually, like, it's still open, but it's not open knowledge. I wanted to make one more point about repair, and I think that this it's in contrast to this expert open knowledge. The really accessible open knowledge of the right to repair. And I wanted to highlight some projects that I've just become aware of that are along with the public knowledge in the US, are lobbying for a right to repair. within the US legal system. And this right to repair, if we think about it, is actually a real democratization of knowledge, right? Because we have huge problems in the world right now because you can't repair your own car if things go wrong. And your iPhone, if you get it repaired illegally, might suddenly stop working because Apple's new update to their operating system retroactively shuts down your iPhone 6 if anybody who wasn't an Apple store ever repaired it, right? Think about this in terms of access to knowledge, access to communications, access to each other. If we cannot repair the things upon which we depend to speak to each other, we cannot really have speech rights. So I think of this sort of, you know, this right to repair as something that could be a very, very broad knowledge right, as well as something that is applicable to this sort of open expertise.
Yeah.
You see?
Amen. What can I say to that? Actually, I wanted to take a slightly different tangent, and I wanted to ask Matthias about. So I think it's very interesting. So the premise for the project was the sort of frustration with hacking existing hardware on one hand, and then to be able to do things that you want. But it's also it is physical piece of hardware, complicated kit, but it's also a tool. It's a camera, and camera is used by creatives to create things. So what kind of conversations have you had with people who don't want to build the camera, but want to do different kinds of things with the camera that currently isn't possible?
I think it's interesting to because it's not only a tool; it's actually also a way of thinking about the whole production chain in a way of in the end producing a movie or an image. Yeah, because of course the camera is just the beginning. We are talking about so many different aspects, such as standardization. Yeah, while standardization is good, yeah, of course we need a lot of standards because then it's also easier to reuse information or to reuse technology in a way, but these standards need to be open, because for example, if we wouldn't need, if we wouldn't have a standard how an HDMI standard, it would not be easy to output the image because you have like 50 different standards. Also, of course, there's a problem because the HDMI standard then has some small royalties you have to pay to some different people. So it's like in every single aspect of the whole chain, there is like somebody making a few bucks with something. It's ridiculous in a way. But also, looking at the chain further, as soon as you capture this image, like how do you store it? How do you post-process it? So this the idea also behind the whole project, behind the Apertus Association, is also to open up as much as aspects as possible for movie production, for like film production, digital production, which is actually sometimes crazy, and sometimes you end up being laughed at, sometimes even by people. So nobody believed us that it's like possible to make a camera in the beginning, but now it's like existing. So I think you have to also try it. Yeah, it's possible, and it's like, but you cannot do it alone. Like you need to team up, and then these kinds of things get possible in a way. I don't know if this answered your question at all, but.
Yeah.
Do you want to?
No, it's good.
Yes. Okay.
No.
Yeah. You wanted to ask.
Oh, what was I? Now I've forgotten what I was going to say. It went on too long. Exactly. That's like the wave. The wave. I've got to catch my wave of thought before it breaks. Otherwise, sea is just calm.
Yeah. It's a sound effect that we can do at this point, 3 days into a festival, to help with the calling of the conversation.
Yeah, so I think it's also important to understand that some, of course, there's a few limits of openness also with this project, such as the camera you will always have. Like, for example, when does it not make sense to design some hardware for yourself? Like, of course, you always have possibilities to reuse existing hardware, but then it's like some kind of ethical community decision when to consider something truly, in a way, Is it like open enough that we can use it? So this discussion is happening very often within the community. So for example, in this version of the camera, we're using one small board, which is pre-produced. It's called the micro set. It has some specific features that we could use, but also by using this kind of external hardware that is not actually designed and produced actually by your own context, you run into totally different problems, which is this dependency, of course, on the producers. For example, if you would be able to produce your own sensor, it would be, of course, much more expensive, but you would know how much it costs at all times. Because what is a big problem also for a lot of open hardware projects is that suddenly the supplier for a key technology stops making this hardware available to you or makes it more expensive because they get pressured by closed source companies. It happened before.
I remember what I was going to talk about. I was going to talk about reverse engineering. Because I think, you know, linking again to this sort of broader question of access to knowledge, re-engineering becomes a kind of quite radical way to like reappropriate knowledge and to pull back some of the enclosure of knowledge into things like patented systems. And if anybody has ever looked at the patent system, I mean, in principle, patents are actually there to allow us to identify what knowledge has gone before, right? Because the knowledge is filed in a repository which is accessible. But it has been the commercialization of patentable knowledge that has turned the patent system from a place to find out what people already knew so that you could build on it to being a kind of set of defenses to, like, you know, enclose and commodify knowledge. So I think there's a few things that we could possibly do as people who are interested in opening up knowledge. And one of them is to use patents in the ways that they were originally conceived, which is to ask for patents, like ask to see patents that are similar to things you want to do, and then do things that are similar to those patented things, but build on them, and then make those open. Right? Because you can. There's nothing to say that you can't use patented knowledge to create open knowledge. And the other thing we can do is reverse engineer, which takes much more time and requires much more expertise, but is what works in a similar vein. And I think the third thing that we can do is that we can, as much as possible, think about the consequences of standards. So I'm such a nerd that I managed to get elected to the British Standards Institute standard setting body on foundational standards for the Internet of Things. And you're all, you know, like, you should all laugh at me because this is the most ridiculous thing I have ever done. But I consider it a like mode of activist infiltration because I'm like gonna have to comment on any standard that they pass for the Internet of Things. And as everybody in this room knows, the main problem with the Internet of Things is that it is extraordinarily siloed into highly proprietary technologies that each run on their own individual protocol, don't interoperate, and eventually are going to completely break and leave us with a world in which, like, we can't get anything done because our refrigerator doesn't talk to our watch, and, you know.
Can we add some brilliant?
Thank you for approving of my decision to make standards.
Open it up to the floor, actually, because we have, a good period here to kind of like take questions. I mean, 20 minutes or more. So, do we change the lights for this part of the situation? No, we stay with the same light situation. Oh, there we are. So, would anybody like to comment or raise a question or?
Hi. I'm interested in what people's motivations are for going open source. So is it about opening up your supply chain and methods of production? Is it about making your product modifiable or repairable? And that comment about, well, the Arduino isn't open source because there's proprietary chips on the board, but how far back do you take that? How many turtles down until it's about where your minerals come from to create those chips? Is it about the factory it's built in, or is it about, you know, the mine that the minerals came from? Yeah.
Maybe I can just explain a little bit at least from my perspective. So I think it pretty much depends on what product we're talking about. Like, it's very much different for open software than for open hardware, of course. But also looking at open hardware, we have totally different motivations why to open up, why to make things open hardware or like or freely available. But it's mostly for me and for the people also at the Axiom project, because of constraints that you have, you cannot control the complete workflow, and you are basically you cannot, for example, use a different codec which is not used or like not supported by the camera manufacturer. You cannot like it goes so far. Like if you want to change the way how the image is actually composed, because it's there's a kind of a way how an image gets actually digitized that you could even change. Yeah, you can never go so deep into the technology, although you might come up with a better solution that looks nicer. Yeah? Or if you want to, especially for archival purposes, it sucks so bad, because there's like all these kind of technologies are smart in a way, which means they take the decision away from you if you don't want them to be smart. Like, for example, sweeten the image, like this is, which is very bad thing for digitization of existing analog material. It's like changing the actual way of seeing the colors. So you can have a lot of constraints that you could work around if these things are documented or more interfaceable with. And in a way, this is in a very large contrast to what we have out there in production tools for like, especially in like audiovisual production, like cameras or like audio equipment. And it goes in so far that there's like huge communities creating their own alternative firmwares. We're also working together, for example, with the Magic Lantern project, which maybe some of you know, which is an alternative firmware for the Canon cameras to open up more possibilities to use it. And a lot of people are using it because you have like more options than you would have in professional cameras, in quite cheap, affordable cameras. So I think reverse engineering and this kind of these communities are super important for contemporary production to make certain qualities of production available to with cheap technology.
And I'd kind of come at it from more an education perspective, and working on open source education projects, and going back to your question about what is the motivation of that, I thought it was a really useful turn of phrase that Alison had, which was the genealogy of openness. And I think that when you start to get into, like, you take a bit of proprietary software, particularly in education, and like when you're like thinking about tools in schools to support children of 4 and 5 plus to learn things, right, in the most human way, you would want those tools to be freely available, readily available, and that anybody, no matter what their economic situation or their social situation, can actually have access to. And so on a personal level, when my motivation comes at it from this kind of side, from an educational perspective, and the right and necessity to be able to learn from each other in this kind of most human way, in a sense. But this genealogy of openness, the minute you start to kind of break open the kind of proprietary product, you start kind of like, it's like forensics. You start to kind of go into this process where you're actually sort of seeing this chain of production and where the money, you're following the money in a sense, right? And when you follow the money, it smells, you know, and it smells really bad. And going to your point about like ecological issues and the footprint of that, you get down far enough and you're actually like, you know, you're in the mines, like you say, and you're just kind of screwing up the environment. And for me, this is like also a really important aspect of what we're talking about here, is that when you kind of start to engage with that process on a personal level or in your group or in your community, you actually start to be shocked at the level of practices that we are now so are now so present, so deeply present in our society, that you are feeling maybe slightly disempowered that you can do anything because you're talking about monopolies and giants. And in your small kind of human scale, that seems to be kind of like very difficult to kind of go up against. But I think the power of what we're talking about, this, you know, following this, you know, mining in a sense, unwrapping, reverse engineering, allows you at least to empower yourself and have a greater sense of awareness of what you're actually buying into, and perhaps be able to make some choices, even if it feels like you are knitting in some way. I keep using this reference for some reason. Out of the anxiety of that trap, right, of that production trap that you're in. And there is a sense of like positive hope in that, in a sense, I think. And that's the motivation on my personal level.
I just wanted to very shortly comment on a totally different point of view, in a very practical sense. So first of all, in what I showed today, this was not really so much part of this, like, it wasn't really part of the whole development. It was the interfacing to the audience in a different sense. But what I'm seeing at the university, how the mindset has changed over the years, is that long time ago, it was more like the media artist, designer, magician who would work in the studio secretly. And then it was almost like that it would be very protective about your invention, and then ta-da, you show it on the stage as the kind of auteur. Today, it's of course, I mean, it's passé to say how the, like, so the fact that we're using open source tools, it's kind of defaults to the same, like, it's in the mindset of the community anyway, and that's, therefore, it's much, like, it's completely understandable, and it's like the obvious thing, of course, it will stay like that. As a counter or as an example of that where it didn't work is that, so at the design studio work, then we do one-off installations. So we are kind of a mini community. So we spent many years working on some tools that were kind of gradually growing, but it wasn't really a community outside. And at some point we realized that the wider community was developing much faster, and our little corner kind of became irrelevant, or that the development couldn't go as fast as that. So we ended up open sourcing some of the tools without it having a community, and it was kind of irrelevant at that time. So it's like the strategy of how to do that and when to do that, I've been kind of more kind of stumbling into things and not really having the conversation at the beginning is not often the case, but it's just like as things grow, you realize and then you react to that. So, yeah.
Thank you. I think there's also some motivations that haven't been mentioned yet. I think one is that you can sometimes turn more extrinsic motivation into intrinsic motivation by becoming or doing something open source hardware, that it's not your boss telling you what to do, but you are much more into the field or the things you really like or find interesting. And the other one is that by becoming open, you have also the opportunity to start a conversation with the world around you. And I think that's very much key to the process, for me at least, that then I'm really in an open conversation with the rest of the world, and that's most exciting, I think.
Hi. Yes. Does it work? Okay. Well, I was intrigued by the lingering question of how to design, how to really penetrate the question where the openness starts and ends. And I think there is a potentially useful strategy how to tackle this question. And I would like to draw from design theory, which basically says that it is much, much useful to look at design as a process rather than as producing objects. And if we take this as an axiom from which we can build our argument, then we could say that this process starts either on finding problems that designer can solve, or even solving problems. And I think if design is really about finding and solving problems, then we could say that the best or most useful place for design, that design could be open to participation, is at this very beginning where outsiders, people could actually interact with designers and help them define these problems that are need to be solved. And I would like just to add something to it, because I'm also very interested in the role of design in public policy and designing services and so on. I think there is one great example in Denmark, this Danish group called MindLab, which is basically intergovernmental design agency working with the Danish government, helping to redefine what education is about and so on. And to finish it, and they exactly start this open design process at the very beginning, asking the people what the problem is and what they could help to solve. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, that's a really good point. What I was going to say about where does openness start is that the answer is actually, it depends. And I think that's actually a good answer, because in some contexts, openness begins at the beginning, so that your design process is always a participatory one. And in my work with designers, one of the things that I have done has been to think about that the beginning of problem definition as being open as well. So not just the outcome, but actually the definition of the problem is something that is open to different inputs. But that won't work for everything. And in some cases, the purpose of the openness is to have the knowledge accessible at the end, right? Because sometimes you need to know that and this is where movements for transparency come from. You can have movements for consultation, which are open at the beginning, and movements for transparency, which are open at the end. Or you can have processes where the workings are trying to be made visible. And I think Matthias and I were talking about different sorts of things, and actually so were you, Jussi. So I don't have a problem with openness being able to appear at different parts of a process, or whether or an openness being about an outcome. But I think we should be a little bit more specific, because that will help. Because if we just keep saying, oh, but it's open, and we don't say how it's open, or to whom is it open, or under what circumstances it's open, or with what intention. My most recent work is about conflicts between process and outcome. So is it better to have an open process where everybody is debating, or is your actual goal to make knowledge commons more accessible? Because at the moment in the hacker culture, these are totally conflated, and that's a problem. So if we could be really specific and say, right now, I'm just interested in participation, and I'm interested in getting more voices in the room, and we actually don't care if we have a good outcome, I would be happier with that than just assuming that the means and the ends are somehow going to be achieved, you know, without specifying.
Another aspect, actually, of how these open processes change the design process is, of course, looking at the material decisions that you make. Like, for example, with the camera, we were thinking in terms of repairability, but also that people can tinker around a lot with it. And then you are starting to make totally different decisions on which parts to use. For example, you would use parts that are lasting very long, or like standardized, so everyone can replace them cheaper. But in the end, it makes the product, of course, more expensive. But then it gains another attribute, which is like repairability. So I think it like open design perspective. So these sorts of decisions change the design process by far, because then you don't look to make the cheapest, smallest gadgets, but to make the most repairable and most durable devices, for example. Just another aspect, maybe.
I actually heard most of the things I wanted to ask now, but I'm curious, maybe more specifically in this, how maker culture can kind of escape what software free software culture with this appropriation by corporate openness happened. What is the way, kind of, in your opinions, to maneuver out of these constraints of seeing openness and making as kind of only productive acts? I'm interested in, like, when can we start seeing making as like counter productive or being critical to production mechanism? Maybe it's easier to talk about can we think of making as kind of a process of disturbing existing ideas of what products should be out there, which products should be kind of available, accessible, to whom, and why they are not being made by industries? Why we are exclusively getting certain types of products and not the other type? Because I'm kind of facing all this enthusiasm from fab labs over and over again when you come to like a new fab lab opening, that there is always like three or four types of models you always see everywhere. It's like 3D printed, you know, models from Star Wars. It's like a mini furniture, and there is like third or fourth thing with bikes, and it's like just replicating itself endlessly. And I'm thinking, is there a way to politicize the movement and kind of make it a little bit more articulated to its own working, so that we can actually see objects that confront industrial production, that confront appropriation by you know, these liberal ideas of openness?
So I think one of the ways to do this is to politicize, to repoliticize craft and making, and to think about what's in the fab lab and what's not in the fab lab. And I think about this through my own family history, and how basically, like, I'm really all wrong because I was not interested in craft. So I come from a large matriarchal family in which people were really interested and very, very good at crafting, and including things that are very highly technical, like knitting very, very complicated patterns. I don't know if you saw me yesterday. I was wearing an incredibly complicated hand-knitted sweater. So these are like technical. These are technical skills. They're also material skills. They are like open mostly. There were lots of course, proprietary knitting patterns. You might have to buy a book for a knitting pattern, but mostly these are things that have, for a very long time, been transmitted through open communities of practice. But you don't find knitting circles usually in fab labs. And so I think it's a very interesting set of questions to begin to ask to get at this repoliticization, and to start to ask why a particular kind of making gets valorized within the fab lab. Because there's a lot of making and sharing and technical and craft work that is happening and has happened throughout human history that does not get valorized by the fab lab. And if you start asking what's in the fab lab and what's not in the fab lab, you might find the answers to be things in the fab lab are things that might more easily get absorbed into a product-oriented or commercial-oriented or competitive-oriented frame.
Yeah, well, but I mean, even more, I think that the way I've experienced in my work in all these different roles is this kind of a very optimistic, it's this sort of a technological advance. So, I mean, what you find in the fab labs is really like, it's a new thing. And I'm also very much coming from Finnish countryside with nonstop handicrafts making with the welding machine in the garage, and everybody is knitting. And actually, we talked with Juha Huskonen the other day about how actually it's not so special in Finland, that it's like it's not out of the ordinary to have people knitting in the public, because it's part of the cultural identity, the sort of a post-war out of the necessity kind of making, that then today with the conveniences of today, it's then taken more of the kind of a emotional, the narrative overtone of the reason of why we're doing these things. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's really, I think there's this kind of a technological drive and the politics behind it, why these things are the way they are. But I mean, at the same time, I think we still need to let them fab labs run for a while for people to understand the specifics of those ways of doing things. And then in hopefully in near future, we will get out of the demos that in the before the fab labs in the virtual reality labs of the day, you could do the fly over the Silicon Valley 3D model that everybody was showing for the exact same reason, because they are spectacles. I mean, they are spectacles that are there for the showing and not really about the individual personal making, which is the whole point of it, is that you can do something that is not available through the mainstream. And this cannot be out of the box because it's not yours.
I think what we also have to consider when we're talking about politicization of maker culture is, first of all, ask ourselves why we're using these terms, maker or make. It comes from a certain perspective, and when make magazine, so it has like a history which is, I would say, like more coming from the American context, and we know, it's like already exclusive because we're talking about a certain amount of people having access to these kind of technologies to be able to go into a fab lab, which is like age, different aspects of exclusion already happening. But also, of course, and this is also a problem we face a lot in this context of open hardware. You have a lot of other turtle on turtle problems. So you could actually start think about what is the material, where's your Arduino actually produced? There's a lot of different, or where's, like I'm always pitching around so much about Arduino, it's great, it's just the most easy example that everyone knows. But there's like a lot of other open hardware projects where people and companies can of course reproduce the materials, and then the question is, where is this produced? Where does the, where's this technology, the materials, where's it actually coming from? So where's the labor of the, where are the chips produced? There's a lot of questions also from, which are in the end, which you maybe not see looking in the fab lab or looking at what is done there, but there's a lot of aspects where this could be repoliticized, in my opinion. This is also, of course, if we look at what kind of products are always produced and or what kind of things are produced always with a 3D printer. It's also, I think, like 90% maybe the same things are printed nonstop.
I'm a little bit conscious of time, and perhaps some people here want to go to still be here, but I'd like to also respond to this because it actually builds in a conversation that's also sort of been running nicely actually through the make strand. And your question is in some ways like, why, what's the political agenda with all the fab labs in a sense and all the maker labs? And it was a reference that Kaisis Vernalis brought up in his keynote, which Jussi heard in a conversation, which he checked later on, which was an article in The New Yorker, which was related to the turn of the century, the revival of the arts and crafts movement. And then we were speaking basically about how in Ireland, where I come from, and also in Finland, when we were breaking from our kind of colonial superiors, there was this re-identification process happened through a making culture, you know, so a revival basically through the arts, through the craft movement, which enabled you to say, yes, I'm Irish, I can knit, you know, yes, I'm Finnish, I can draw a very beautiful flower in a sense, you know. So this is actually kind of interesting, right? Because this is about identity formation. Okay, and so as we were just kind of having a little chat just before the session started, I started to think of like these fab labs and maker labs are also processes of identification. And what is that a process of identification that's actually happening? It's a process which is actually to say, I'm a knowledge worker, I'm a creative. And this is the driving type of skill set of our economy, okay? So what's politically happening here is basically where providing further spaces for the future factory workers. And that's what's happening really make our culture in a way. And given the kind of the theme of our actual panel, I think this is kind of what's happening. And that's a political act. That's a very strategic thing, because the skill sets that we so value now, creativity and creative industries and knowledge workers, you know, when you break down the skill sets of the knowledge workers, it's adaptability, flexibility, creativity, constant movement, constant be able to kind of change. And the spring of where these things are kind of happening, not only across the northern sort of hemisphere, where all of our old industrial kind of processes are kind of after collapsing, we really need to reinvent ourselves. This is political stuff, you know, and why is there popping up in China and so forth and in this kind of global, these particular countries as well, is because those countries have had challenges to how they educate, which are considered as that they are not like the knowledge workers, creative workers. So these are kind of political movements in a sense. And I think it's kind of interesting then when we think about future factories, just to, I guess, restate what I was just after saying, that there is that agenda going on, and it's maybe something to kind of consider in the cafe or over a beer. I would just like to thank, I'm so happy with this panel. It's been a privilege to chair the Make Stream, and this is kind of one of the main closing hybrid events. But tomorrow, just for those who are kind of interested in continuing to follow us, Jussi will also be working in a workshop with some of his colleagues from the Rethinking Prototype Project and also from Laborel in Spain. That'll happen actually at 6 o'clock tomorrow. And also, I'd like to encourage you to attend the workshop on making 5 anxieties that Matthias, Jamie Allen and colleagues also have been following. So there's some threads tomorrow in MakerStream. And plus, if you're really feeling anxious and you want to return to your body, the very brilliant Brody Condren will be running a LARPing kind of session called Effective Systems, which I'd encourage you, if you haven't already, to sign up for. And that's at 12 o'clock in the middle of the day. So thank you again to Alison, Jussi and Matthias for all the food for thought. Thank you for your participation, and have a good evening. And you can have a look at the prototypes and also collect some information.